Hello friends. Now in this session, we are going to discuss about the enhancing safety in chemical industry. Under the safety in chemical and petrochemical industrial aspects. So in this presentation, our focus is to enhance the safety. As we know that there are various safety measures, precautions are to be taken by the chemical industries because the hazardous chemicals, flammable chemicals, explosive chemicals, toxic chemicals, etc. may be handled, stored or processed in the chemical industries. And many times, unfortunately, it happens that many chemical accidents are also there in the chemical industry. And that is why we have to focus on enhancing the safety. The safety is already present in the chemical industry, but we have to enhance by some of the parameters. So let us discuss what exactly the parameters are involved to enhance the safety in chemical industry. So basically, the chemical industry is more serious about the safety aspects, as we have mentioned that many chemical which may be a dangerous to our life as well as health. They may be a flammable, explosive, etc. And that is why we have to focus on that. So before finalizing that chemical industry location, we have to think twice, thrice, etc. Why? Because in case if an accident is happen, and if that case is major accident, then that may impact on the surrounding area of that chemical industry. And that is why government always think of that chemical industry a separate location, a separate MIDC sector, or it may be a red zone, right? Because these industry have a huge potential as compared to the other industries to impact on the surrounding area, that may be a residential area, that may be a farming area, that may be some highways, roads, etc. But in case of major accidents, so these accidents may impact on these types of area, and there are more chances of fatalities in all types of accidents in the chemical industries. And that is why these are the guidelines and some of the criteria that is called as selection criteria or the parameters on which the location of industries are depends, like the land availability and its cost. So that is the from economical point of view. So we have to purchase that land for this particular chemical industry, and generally as due to the Petroleum Act, petroleum rules, due to the gas cylinder rule, etc., we have to follow all these standards and rules and practices. For and in that rules and regulations, the distance criteria is mentioned for the storages, for the handling, for the processes. And due to this distance criteria, the area requirement in the chemical industry is always more than the other types of industries. So that land is required in more, and that is why that particular area should be available first, and then we have to check about this cost. So if that land is available and the cost is affordable to that organizations, then they can go for the purchase. Then before finalizing all these purchasing or all the planning, they have to check the raw material availability. So what exactly you are going to manufacture, you are going to produce in that chemical industry. On that basis, we have to list out the raw materials, their quantities requirement on a daily basis, on monthly basis, quarterly basis, yearly basis, etc. With reference to the suppliers, the reliability, availability, quality, etc. So all the things should be checked with the raw materials. Then whether the labors can be available in that area or not. whether the residential areas or some villages are available, whether the unskilled, skilled labors may be available in that area or not, whether if the area, residential area is far away from that chemical industrial zone, then can we provide the transportation media, etc. So all the feasibility should be checked by that organization. Then infrastructure availability. So whatever the infrastructure requirements are there, that may be a organization building, that may be administrative area, that may be some offices, that may be some cabins like security cabin, and that may be some houses, that may be some residential area. So depending on the type of organization, depending on the scale of organizations, they have to finalize these infrastructure facilities. Then access to the market. So whatever the local purchase is there, on from that point of view, we have to purchase some of the things from the local market. Then we have to sell our product also. So for that point of view also, we have to check the access to the market. So for the purchase, for the selling, where exactly the market is available and whether the access is okay or not. Then transport facility. So the transport facility may be for the raw material point of view, from the intermediate point of view, for the final product point of view, for the local purchase point of view, for all the types of transportation facilities that may be for the public or the employees which are available in the organizations. So all the things should be checked before finalizing all these location. Then drinking and process water facility. So whether the ample amount of drinking water is available or not, whether the corporation or some local authority connections are available or not, what exactly the quality of that water is. And if it is needed, we have to process that water, that is through the filtration units or carbon units or RO, etc. So whatever it may be. So you have to check all the things before finalizing the locations. Then sewage and drainage. So what exactly the facilities, the distances, the pipelines, the nearby sewage facility, nearby drainage facility, nearby sewage treatment plant or nearby effluent treatment plant. If any CETP is available, common effluent treatment plant, then how to connect with that. If it is not available, then we have to design our own ETP, STP and some drainage facilities also. Then place for the solid and liquid waste disposal. So for the disposing these solid and liquid waste, we have to check whether if any common facility is available or not. If the common facility is available, then it is well and good. It can be controlled by that common authority, local authority of governments. If it is not the case, then we have to develop our own disposal facilities. Then interlinking with other plants. So if in any case, if other plants are going to support you or you can support to the other plants also, that may be related to the disposal facility or some drainage sewage facility, that may be related to the drinking water facility, that may be related to the raw material supply facility or employee related facilities, etc. So whatever it may be, if it is there, if it is feasible, then you can interlink with the other plants. Then surrounding population density and distance from the public. So we already discussed that. We have to check whether the public or the employees are available in nearby area, which is located at this location. Then distance from the highways and railways and from the public also. So the highways, railways, and these distances, especially from the transportation point of view. So that may be a public transportation or the transportation facilities for the employees. That may be from the raw material or the product transportations. So all the things we have to check what exactly the distances are and what is the transportation cost for that purpose to connect these highways and railways. Then suitability of climate, environment, factors related to the ecology, geology, meteorology, micro and macrobiology. In some of the chemical industries, in specifically some of the chemical processes, we have to check these environmental factors, this climatic conditions, because in most of the cases in chemical industries, the structures are having the mild steel as a main material for the supporting structures, for the reactions, reactors, for the vessels, for the storage tanks, and many pipelines are there in that chemical industries. And that is why we have to check the humidity, we have to check the temperature, we have to check the wind velocities, wind pressures in that area, etc. Because sometimes the corrosion rate may be more due to the high temperature, due to the high humidity, and these factors may affect on the structures as well as on the process, as well as on the efficiency of the peoples who are working in that area. Then government policy advantages like subsidies, incentives, zoning, etc. If there is a particular zone where some subsidies are given, if some incentives given by the government, or if your company is going to accept some renewable energy sources rather than the fossil fuel sources, then also you may get the subsidies. So there are different policies are there. So with reference to these policies, you can absorb these different advantages of subsidies, incentives, and zoning areas. Then other techno-economic criteria. So whatever the technical feasibility, whatever the economical feasibility, so these two criteria should be checked. And nowadays, we are also checking on the environmental factors also. So nowadays, the third persons or the persons who have gone through all these technical feasibility check as well as economical feasibility checks, they are also studying the environmental adverse impacts of these chemical industrial processes, storage, transportation, etc. on nearby area at least. So if the technical economical feasibility is okay, if it is accepted one, and even the environmental impacts are at minimum level or at the acceptable level, then we can finalize the location of these chemical industries. So these are some of the guidelines or the selection criteria for the location of industries. Now, if you finalize the location, if you go for the manufacturing process, if you start the operation, then we have to check mainly the hazardous area, because we are thinking of enhancing the safety in the chemical industry. So we are focusing only on the safety factors. So hazardous means the petroleum having flash point below 65 degrees Celsius. In case if it is in the gaseous state or in the vapor state. If it is in the liquid state, then the flash point above 65 degrees Celsius. So we have to check the hazardous material. So hazardous form, that may be a liquid form, that may be a gaseous form or vapor form. And what are the chances of ignition? What are the chances of fire? What are the chances of explosion? And what are the exactly technical criteria? So if you go through the petroleum rule, then you can observe the different categories, different technical criteria, where are the chances of the fire and explosion. So this is the area that is called as zone, where it is called as hazardous area. Now, the zone 1, 2, and 3, there are three zones in this area that is called as hazardous area classifications. So what exactly zone 1 means? So in the area in the chemical industry where inflammable gases or the vapors are likely to be continuously present. So from this angle, you can understand if in particular area, there is always chance of present of inflammable gases or vapors, that is the flash point below 65 degrees Celsius. So if the temperature is near about 60 or 65 degrees Celsius, then there are chances of ignition of these gases and vapors. And in case if there is a vapor cloud, vapor formation in that area, then there are again chances of the explosion. So this is the dangerous or the hazardous area, right? So second zone is where they are likely to be present under normal operating conditions, right? So there is chances of present or availability of these inflammable gases or vapors under normal operating conditions. So it is not continuous or always present. So there are chances of always or continuous presence of these inflammable gases or vapors, and that is why that zone is called as zone first, which is more hazardous, and then it is the next less hazardous or moderate hazardous area or zone, that is called as second zone. So it is the normal operating conditions, and in normal operating conditions there are chances of present of these inflammable gases or whatever. It is not continuous or always the presence of these gases. And third zone is where there are likely to be present only under abnormal conditions. So in case if any abnormal operating condition is there, it means there is excessive heating due to some mechanical failure or some instrument failure or some controlling method failure, etc., then only due to these abnormal operating conditions there are chances of these inflammable gases or vapors present in that area. So these 1, 2, 3 zones, generally with reference to the rule, it is called as zone 0, zone 1 and zone 2. So this first zone is called as zone 0, second zone is called as zone 1, and third zone is called as zone 2. And from this table we can understand the zone 0 is more hazardous and dangerous than the zone 1, and zone 1 is more dangerous and hazardous than the zone 2. So in case if any special case is there, if special circumstances is there, and from that point of view, if you want to clarify what exactly the area of that chemical industry is, so whether it is 0, 1 or 2, then that can be clarified by the chief controller. So from the special circumstances and from the special conditions point of view only, this CC is going to increase or reduce this area or zone level activities. So with reference to this petroleum rule, rule number 106, you can understand the fixed electrical apparatus guidelines. So from the zone 0, zone 1 and zone 2, you can understand there are chances of ignition due to different ignition sources. So that may be a static charge, that may be a electrical activity or electronic activity, or that may be a failure of earthing or bonding provisions. So these are the main sources of the ignitions. Then other sources may be there, like frictions or some other heat sources, etc. But normally in the chemical industries, most of the care is taken from for other sources. But with reference to this petroleum rule for the petroleum products, we can understand these fixed electrical apparatus are intrinsically safe or flame-proof type that should be enclosed and homemade safe. So if you want to use this electrical apparatus in this area, like in this zone 0, 1, 2, then you have to go for the flame-proof type of electrical apparatus, or which are intrinsically safe, or which are enclosed, means that there are less chances or zero chances of this ignition source that can conveyed or connected to these gases or vapors. If you are going to use these electrical apparatus in that area, which is essential task or which is not avoidable, then you can go for the purging or pressurizing the atmosphere and interlock to stop the electric supply automatically, or to give the warning to stop in case of failure of purging or pressurizing. So we have to use the inert gases for these purging operations, or some pressurizing systems for this electrical apparatus operation in this zone 0, 1 and 2. So in case if it is failed, that apparatus is failed and there are some chances of ignition sources, then that electric supply should be automatically stopped. So all these provisions should be made, and that is mentioned under the rule number 106. In rule one number 107, the fixed electrical wiring. So it should be effectively sealed at all joints. So if you are going to use this electrical wiring, so that should be fixed, that should be sealed at all joints, mechanically protected, adequately supported, consisting of approved arm cable or metal sheath cable or insulated cables in galvanized conduits and approved flame-proof fittings. So if again it is unavoidable to use this electrical wiring, so again these simple guidelines are given, that should be mechanically protected, adequately supported, sealed, and the main thing is flame-proof fittings. Then as compared to the earthing and bonding provisions with reference to rule number 108, there are different guidelines regarding the resistance of ohms. So for the electrical equipments and systems, that should be earthed with resistance of 4 ohms. For all non-current carrying metallic parts of electrical parts, so that should be earthed with resistance of 10 ohms. And for the all joints and pipelines, walls, plant storage tanks, associated facility, etc., that joint not exceeding 1 ohm resistance. So for all these earthing and bonding provisions, mainly the resistance criteria, that is 4 ohm, 10 ohms and 1 ohm should be followed by the chemical industry organizations as when we are talking about this zone 0, 1 and 2. So we must follow all these petroleum rules which are specially mentioned in the chapter 4, that is electrical installations. Then there is another concept in this enhancing the safety in chemical industry, that is called as LOPA. So LOPA means layer of protection analysis. So this concept in the chemical industry began in 1990. Arthur Dovell and William Bridges, among other, began implementing these techniques. Why we are implementing these techniques, or nowadays why it is famous? Because it is main concept of independent prospective safety systems. So without going for the high degree of quantitative analysis, we can go for the protection of some of the equipments. So in the United States, Europe and some other international agencies, some codes are also involved in this method of LOPA, like CCPS, that is Center of Chemical Process Safety, ICE, that is International Electrotechnical Commissions, which is the standards like ISO, and it is working hand to hand with the ISO also, especially focusing on the electrical or electronic oriented instruments. Then International Society of Automation, that is ISA. So these all agencies began to refer LOPA as a method of determining the required SIL, that is safety integrity level. So normally we know about the SIL, that we are checking or calculating the SIL. And for this SIL, this LOPA is good technique to support this SIL. And that is why these LOPA are involved especially for the chemical industries. So what exactly this LOPA is? So risk assessment of one cause, one consequence pair. So it is a risk assessment methodology which uses simplified conservative rules to define the risk as a function of both frequency and potential consequence severity. So it is going to define the risk as a function of both frequency as well as the potential. So we are going to check the frequency of that risk. We are going to check the potential of that risk in the simplified way, in the conservative way. So that is called as LOPA. So it is a risk assessment methodology. So these are the factors, that is process life cycles, showing the LOPA is typically used for this research, process development, process design, operations, maintenance, modifications, and decommissionings. So this LOPA can be applicable for all these parameters. So we can apply this LOPA to these things and we can check the risk from the frequency point of view as well as from the potential point of view. So this is a picture where you can understand the different layers are involved under these LOPA systems. And this layer may be a community emergency response, then plant emergency response, physical protections, physical protection of relief devices, automatic actions, SIS or ESD, critical alarms, operators, supervision and manual interventions, basic control, process alarms and operator supervision, and the process design. So if the parameter can be controlled with the help of process design itself, then we can control that risk at the department or that particular local location itself. If it is not the case, then we can go for the basic controls, some process alarm systems, and we can also take a support of the operator supervisions. So with the help of the expertise and the supervision of that operator, we can control the risk again. If these two layers are not effective, then we can go for the critical alarm systems, operator supervision, and manual interventions likewise. So we can go for the different layers if the first layer is not effective for controlling the different risk. Likewise, we can apply these LOPA systems for the different parameters. Then the next safety aspect in the chemical industry is SIS, that is safety instrumented system. So the function of this SIS is a set of equipment intended to reduce the risk due to the specific hazard. That is the main simple intention. So SIS clearly mentions that there are instrumental set or the different instruments and equipments are involved in these systems from the safety point of view. So if the liquid level is reduced as compared to the standard liquid level, or if it is in the excess, if the pressure is exceeded than the design pressure or the safety limits, if the temperature is more than the expected temperature in the reaction vessel or the storage vessel, etc. So these are the different indicators where we have to control all these parameters like temperature, pressure, liquid level, flow, etc. So for that purpose, we need instruments. And that is why this instrumented system is there to control the safety aspects, to control or reduce the risk and the potential in that chemical industry. So in most of the cases nowadays, the automatic systems are there, which is automatic SIS systems are there. So this system is designed to monitor the dangerous conditions in a plant, in an operation unit, and take action in the event of dangerous conditions. So we already discussed the dangerous conditions like temperature change, that may be at lower or the upper case, the pressure change, the liquid level change, the flow rate change, some ignition source is there, some ignition is there, some fire is catches, etc. So whatever the conditions are there, so in some of the cases that may be a gas leakage, in some of the cases that may be a liquid spillage, in some of the cases that may be a combination of all these things, etc. So whatever the dangerous conditions are there in that chemical industry, that should be noted down by these instruments, and then the automatic action should be taken by this SIS system. So that is the simple concept of the SIS. So this SIS can reduce the danger or the sequence of the consequences. So this SIS comprises sensors. So sometimes we have to sense the leakage of the gases. That is why some sensors are there. In some of the cases, some vapors are there. In some of the cases, some gases are there. So gases may be a toxic one, gases may be a flammable one, gases may be an explosive one, etc. So for detecting these different types of gases in that area, we have to use these sensors. Then logic solvers. So if that gas is sensed and this is the maximum permissible limit in this area, then we have to control the gases. So how to control that? So we have to control the opening or closing of the wall systems. So likewise, these to solve these problems, some logic solvers are used, and then we have to take the actions. So some actuators are used. So whose purpose to take a process to safe state when normal predetermined set points are exceeded or safe operating procedures are violated. So this is called as the controlling systems. So sometimes it is a open loop controlling system, sometimes it is a closed loop controlling systems, and in nowadays most of the cases closed loop controlling system with automatic controlling sensors devices are utilized in the chemical industries, because in the chemical industries seconds and minutes are very important, because in very less time this fire or the explosion can connect with the other tanks or with the other vessels or with other processes also. So this layer implies that there is a safety instrumented systems or an emergency shutdown device that does not depend upon any operator interactions. For example, burner of boilers, photo detectors are present that automatically shut down the gas flow in the microseconds. So variety of examples are available in the chemical industries from where you can control the different parameters like pressure, temperature, level, flow, etc. Then for these SIS systems, some instruments are required. So we have discussed about the automatic systems. We have discussed about the automatic systems in which sensors, logic solvers or actuators are involved. And in some of the cases, we required some instruments to measure the different parameters. So to measure the different parameters for the monitoring systems also, for the observation supervision systems also, we need some basic instruments. So these basic instruments like anemometer. So instrument for measuring the speed of wind or any other moving gases. So for that purpose, we have to check with the anemometer. So for checking the speed of wind, so that may be a natural wind, that may be a fan speed, that may be a blower speed, that may be some other speed of wind or some gases. So we have to use these anemometers. Nowadays, this is the simple, handy and digital apparatus with good sensors. So we can check the wind speed within second itself. Then barometers for measuring the atmospheric pressures, then calorimeter for determine the quantities of heat evolved, absorbed and transferred. So we have to check the calories involved in that particular process. Then hydrometer for measuring the density or relative density of liquid. Then hygrometer for measuring the relative humidity of the atmosphere, then bolometer for measuring the heat radiation, Borden gauge, that is the pressure gauge for the steam boiler, then cryometer for measuring the low temperature, then dilatometer for measuring the volume change of substance, and likewise the densimeter, viscometer, thermopile, thermometer, spectrophotometer, pyrometer, rotameter, and tensimeter. So these are the basic some of the instruments which are normally used in the chemical industry. There are variety of instruments that may be used for other for measuring the other parameters also. So that is depending on the conditions under this chemical industry. Then these are the some of specific instruments which can be used for enhancing the safety in the chemical industries. So like gas detectors, so we have already discussed that to control the hazard which is related to the gas, and that gas may be a toxic one, that may be a flammable one, that may be an explosive one, etc. So to detect that gas or fume or vapors, we have to use some detector systems, we have to use some detector plus alarm systems, or we have to use some combinations of other systems in which that system can go for the gas detections. Then that can gives you the alarms, that may be in terms of sound, that may be in terms of lights. And again, then some system is there that should be actively, automatically operated on the basis of these detections. So in case if there is a leakage or gasket is leaked or breaked, and then we have to take the action that this valve should be bypassed, and if there is a provision of other valve, then that line should be used. So likewise, that is depending on the condition, automatically that system should be operated, right? So this is the electronic instruments where sensor, automobile alarm to give warning, and then preset air gas that is toxic or explosive mixture exceeds the threshold limit values or lower explosive limit values or upper explosive limit values. So when we are talking about the TLV, that is related to the toxic gases, and LEL, ULE is related to the explosive gases. So we have to take care about the health of the employees, as well as the, we have to reduce the chances of fire as well as the explosion in this area. And that is why we have to check the upper limit or maximum limits, which is given by the different standards. It detects the flue gases, LPG, smoke, petrol, vapors, gases, etc. Then there are some other instruments specific like metal detectors. So this instrument is going to detect only metal. So it detects metallic objects of ferrous and non-ferrous metals hidden in the pocket or bag, etc. So it is like a torch and has a piezo alarm systems. Then electronic flasher, it can be used as a danger indicator or attracting the attentions of the employees. Then electronic air cleaner for indoor use up to an area 25 square meter for pollution free clean atmosphere, and wherever bad odor problem is there, it reduces the secondary smoking and control virus regarding the growth of bacteria. So this is air cleaner electronic apparatus. Then alcohol detecting instruments are also there. So with electronic alarm to warn before drivers sit behind the wheels or workers on the machines, thus prevent them from the alcohol consumptions when they are on the duty. So there are various types of specific instruments which can be utilized in the chemical industries to avoid the hazards, risk, and the accidents. Then this is a process control instruments now. So mainly, if you observe the statistical data, most of the accidents are related to the temperature, pressure, vacuum level, and flow parameters. And that is why these parameters should be controlled. So these are called as process parameters. So in the process, these parameters are very important, because due to this particular temperature and pressure conditions only, these products are manufactured with that particular quality and quantity. So for the temperature, thermocouple, radiation parameter, optical parameter, resistance thermometer, all gas thermometer, multiple point potentiometer, then electronic potentiometer, liquid type manometric temperature measuring instruments, and direct acting temperature controlling instruments. These are the different instruments which can be utilized for detection, measuring, and controlling the temperatures. So depending on the conditions, we have to use these different temperature measuring and controlling devices. Then for pressure, the strain gauge, pressure transducer, pressure gauges, vacuum gauges, compound gauge, compound pressure and vacuum gauge, compound and draft gauge, diaphragm type, breathing valves, atmospheric pressure regulator, etc. can be utilized. So we can't discuss each and every instruments with their principal construction, mechanism, advantage, disadvantages and limitations, etc. But we have to list out at least what exactly the instruments are used for enhancing the safety in the chemical industry. That is our main or the basic motive. That is why I'm going to go through only the list of these instruments now. So high vacuum measurements, for that purpose, Bourdon gauge, diaphragm gauge, thermal conductivity gauge, heat filament ionization gauge, and for level, the level indicators, fixed point indicating device, remote liquid indicators, mercury manometers can be utilized. For the flow purpose, flow type manometers, bellows meter, gas flow control, air flow controller, bell type meters, etc. can be utilized. Then for the quality analyzer, photoelectric gas analyzer, gas or vapor monitor alarm devices, and viscosity meters. Then for the revolution meter, then tachometer, governor, air velocity meter, accelerometer, etc. Then for the density and specific gravity, we can use the psychrometer, hygrometers, viewpoints meter, viscometer, and densitometers. So these are the different process parameters which can be measured as well as controlled by these different types of instruments. So this is the simple or the basic diagram, which is called as process control block diagram, in which you can observe that this is the input for this process, and we are using this standard symbol from the instrumentation and process control part. So this is again the plus minus signs. This is error detector, and on the basis of these input verifications, we are going to provide this signal to the controller. Then this is going to actuate on the basis of this controlling parameters on the plant, and then this plant should be kept in a, within a permissible limit. That is normally it is called as set point in the instrumentation and process control part. So we have to check the set points. We have to check the lower limit. We have to check the upper limit. So we have to control all these process parameter, process unit operations under this lower and maximum limit. So that is controlled by this controller, and the signal is given from this error detector. So what exactly error detector means? If it is going beyond the exceed limit or the upper limit, then again that error is going to give the signal to the controller. Even though if it is below to the lower limit, then also that is again error. And this error is in the form of signal is going to convey this message to the controller. And on the basis of this message, so whether the gap is plus or minus, on that basis, the controller is going to control that process parameter. So that may be a pressure, temperature, volume, liquid, flow, or some other parameters. So we have to control these parameters in that safe range, right? And then after this controlling that parameter, we have to give the feedback to the initial level to that error signal. So if this feedback conveys that now the error is zero, there is no gap in between this upper limit or lower limit, it is in the safe range, then there is no signal to the controller again. So this is called as closed loop control feedback systems. In some of the industries, open loop control system is also there, but it is a safe practice to have the closed loop feedback control system, especially when we are talking about the chemical industries. So these are the different symbols for the different instruments and devices which can be utilized for drawing these different process controlling diagrams or the block diagram, that may be a control systems diagram. This is the example in the field or locally mounted. These instrument and devices is indicated by the circle. On a main panel or screen, it is indicated by a circle with a line at the center. Then on a sub panel or a remote location, two lines at the center in the circle, and it is inaccessible, hidden, or back or inside panel, it is a dotted line. So likewise, there are different symbols can be utilized. You can refer the standard symbols with reference to this instrumentation and control. Then process and control system characteristics are the chemical process and operations need sufficient process and control systems and a very variety of instruments for them. So we already discussed the variety of instruments which are used in this system. Then process control system can be classified in machine, reactor, turbine, or compressor control, pressure, temperature, or flow control, and instrumentation control. So with the help of instruments, we are going to control different machines, reactors, turbines, or some other parameters. Then main functions of control systems are to collect information, to measure and display it, to control normal working, and to detect the fault and correct it. So we have to collect the information first. What exactly the pressure in that vessel, what exactly the flow rate of vessel, that may be inlet and outlet nozzles, then what is the level of that particular liquid in that vessel, then what is the pressure of that vessel, etc. After collecting this information, we have to measure and compare and display this information with the standard information or the set points. And on that basis only, we can detect the fault. And if is there any error, that may be a positive or negative, then we have to correct that fault. So what are the process characteristics of these systems? So first is process characteristics, which tend to make the feedback control more difficult, are measurement problem, dead time, recycle, limit cycle, strong interactions, high sensitivity, and changes in the parameters or constraints. So these are some of the characteristics or some of the basic problems which are involved under this process and control systems. Then function wise, they require monitoring, optimization, scheduling, process investigation, plant commissioning, feed forward control, etc. Then there may be a computer control, include direct digital control, programmable logic control, that is PLC, then distribution control system, that is DCS, some SCADA system may be there, some other systems are nowadays involved in the technology. Then present trends in control system is to increase degree of automation and change in operator's role from control to monitoring. So in the previous days, generally, most of the chemical industries are on the basis of manual systems. Then it is converted into the semi-automatic systems. And nowadays, the systems are converted or the operations are converted into fully automatic systems. And that is why we are using these DDC, PLC, DCS systems for 100% automations. I have also observed some of the industries in which only 5 to 7 operators or the monitors are involved for controlling all the process parameters of total industry. I have observed one of the industries in MADA, Mahad industrial area where the raw material of adhesive is manufactured in that industries, and only 7 persons are observing and controlling all these parameters. So this is happen due to the fully automatic systems which are involved in that industry. Then the instrumentation systems for the safety again. So the basic principle for the safety instruments are as follows. That is, instead of providing the elaborate or complex instrumentation systems, the hazard should be reduced. That is our main focus. Then HAZOPS study should be conducted to assess the potential hazards, operating difficulties. Then instrument should be checked regularly and repaired quickly. Control system should be capable of dealing with normal and abnormal conditions. Example, startup and shutdown. Then, as far as possible, instruments design should be fail-safe. The measurement should be of direct variable and direct locations. The human error should be fully considered. Ergonomic principles should be applied for the reducing human error. More positive isolations may be required for double block and bleed wall service instruments. Should be have high integrity, and in case failure, auto control, manual control should be provided for safety. So these are the basic principles for safety instrumentations. Sometimes it is happened that we have to check manually also, because we can't rely 100% on the fully automated systems also. We have to check the actual flow or the actual pressure or the actual temperature or the actual flow rate, etc. And then we have to check whether these actual parameters and the measurement is same as which is displayed on our monitor with the help of this automatic control system, etc. So we have to check on a particular frequency basis manually as well as with the help of automatic control systems. So sometimes it happens that some sensors are failure, some sensors are giving faulty readings to our computers, and we are relying on these readings also. So sometimes with the help of experience only, with the help of good observations and monitorings only, we can understand that if the particular temperature is there, then how this pressure is reduced. So if the temperature is going to increase in a particular vessel, then that pressure should be also increased, and vice versa. So we must know the basic principles or the basic relations between these temperature, pressure, flow rate, volume, etc. So if you know all these things, if you have experience about all these things, then we can understand there is no is there any fault in these instruments or the controlling devices, then we can control these things also. Then safety aspects for the instruments. So instrument failure can also cause an accident. So that is why I'm giving that idea that we can't rely on all the instruments. So sometimes we have to check manually also. And therefore, while designing and manufacturing, it is necessary to consider some safety features of the instruments. Like instrument may fail due to the functional fault or loss of containment from the instruments. Pulsating flow in flow meters can cause inaccuracies. Design of orifice plate should consider this reactor. Material of construction should be proper. Pressure and transmitters and regulators can be damaged by overpressures. If they break their pressure, be safely released. Protection against corrosive fluid is necessary. Then instrument should not become a source of ignition. Electrical area clarifications or the classification should be considered. They should be flame proof as per the requirement, and control wall should be selected properly with the controlling characteristics. So these are the different safety aspects for the instrumentation. Then SIL determinations. So SIL means safety integrity level. So SIL is defined as a relative level of risk reduction provided by a safety function, or to specify a target level of risk reduction. So our main target is to reduce the risk. So this is one of the parameter, that is SIL. So we have to identify these SIL limits first with the help of some standards. So some of the standards like IEC 61508 or IEC 61511, that is International Electrotechnical Commission standards. So these address the procedural steps prior to the SIF, that is safety instrumented functions. So before finalizing these SIF, we have to go for the SIL. And the, for the SIL, the IEC recommends that you should go for the FIRA first, that is Process Hazard Identification and Risk Assessment first. Then you can go for the SIL assessment, and then you can go for the safety function requirement. So for the more details, you can go through these IEC 61508 and IEC 61511. So these standards are the international standards which is related to the electrical and electronic or the different instruments which are operated on the basis of electrical or electronic way. And on the basis of that, these standards are designed. So you can go through that. How to calculate this SIL? So if our acceptable hazard frequency is once in 10 years, then SIF have a risk reduction factor of at least 25. So minimum risk reduction factor, that is RRF, of SIF is equal to effective frequency without SIS or acceptable frequency. So 2.5 divided by 0.1 is 25, and that is why the SIF must have the RRF is 25. So the minimum required RRF of each SIF is used to determine the target SIL level of the SIF. So on the basis of this RRF, that is risk reduction factor, and SIF, we can decide the SIL level. So these guidelines related to the SILs and dangerous failure probability, that is SIL 4321 is given under this table, and high demand mode of operations, that is probability of dangerous failure per hour is between 10 raised to minus 9 and 10 raised to minus 8 for SIL 4. Then for minus 10 raised to minus 8, minus 7 for 3, minus 7, minus 6 for 2, and 10 raised to minus 6, 10 raised to minus 5 in SI 1. So this is again the standard from the IEC 61508. So you can go through the details of these SIL bands, standards, calculations, and the procedure. So SIL assessment is important as per the IEC standards, and that is why it is to be conducted at the detailed design stage of the project. So the initially, if you go for this risk graph, then you can go for the LOPA and then FTA, that is fault tree analysis. So for that purpose, assessment that yield SIL 1 or greater, then assessment that yield unexpected results, and assessment for unusual, unfamiliar system or the risk should be identified. So in, under this SIL assessment, you have to check the unusual, unfamiliar systems or the systems which is at risk. So then you have to decide whether it is at low level risk, medium level risk, or high level risk, etc. And then you have to decide the SIL. So this is all the aspects which is related to the enhancing safety in the chemical industry. Thank you.